I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 17. Tonight we're going to talk a little bit about perfection of character and systematic theology, and we'll try to define systematic theology a little bit later for you, for those who might not understand what that means. It's not really quite so complicated as it seems. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, in verse 41, we're familiar with this story of a young shepherd man. He's hardly quite a boy now, but he's a young man. And he's going to take on the challenge of the greatest warrior in the world. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, and ruddy, and of fair countenance. And the Philistine said unto David, Am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, Come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. I want to ask you a question. Do you think that Goliath was afraid of David? He wasn't afraid at all. Verse 45, Then said David to the Philistine, Thou comest to me with a sword, and with a spear, and with a shield. But I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee, and take thy head from thee, and I will give the carcass of the host of the Philistines to stand to the fowls of the air, and to the wild beasts of the earth, and all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. The Philistine wasn't afraid of David, but was David afraid of the Philistine?
No.
No, he wasn't. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you unto our hands. So who should have been afraid?
Goliath
should have been very afraid. That's right. Suppose that you were walking down a very dark and dreary road one night, and you start to hear certain sounds, creepy sounds. Do you need to be afraid? What if you were on that road and you met the devil himself? Would you be afraid? Would it scare you? Should you be afraid?
No.
Jesus said that all power in heaven and earth has been given unto me. And the Bible says that as many as received him, to them gave he what? Power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. The possession of and the right use of power, friends, is the authority that Jesus has been given. And he's been given that authority in such a way that nobody or nothing can stop him from using it. In James chapter 4, and verse 7, we have some plain counsel, more than counsel, it's a command. James chapter 4 and verse 7, it says, Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Who is really going to be afraid between you and the devil if you have the encounter? If you have submitted yourself to God and if you resist the devil, then he is the one who flees. You don't need to flee. It's interesting that this word resist in the original language, anthestimia, means to set against or to withstand, to resist by actively opposing pressure or power. It's more than just a mental assent. It's more than just a look at something. It means that you're actively involved in resisting. In 1 Peter chapter 5, 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. We're told to be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. And this is that same word that's translated resist in James 4, 7. And the fact is that every time that you find this word in the New Testament, it's always, this is like one of those verbs, you see, I don't know how they have this in Portuguese, but in the Greek you have what are called either active or passive states of a verb. But in every time, it's always in the active state. It's always used in the active state. In other words, friends, we don't passively fight the devil. We kick, we scream, we claw against him in the name of the God. That's right. Now, is there something about our message? Is there something about the three angels' messages that scares the devil? Something that makes him flee. Would you like to know what it is? We've been told in the Review and Herald of March 22, 1887, there is nothing that fears Satan so much as that the people of God shall clear the way by removing every hindrance so that the Lord can pour out His Spirit upon a languishing church and an impenitent congregation. You see, friends, He doesn't want us to stay as a languishing church, and He doesn't want us to be an impenitent congregation very much anymore. But He wants to pour out His Spirit. Now, in my Bible, in Acts chapter 5 and verse 32, I find a very important text. Acts chapter 5 and verse 32. Peter says, I'll let you turn your Acts 5, 32. And we are His witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Spirit, whom God hath given to them that obey Him. In other words, friends, if there's something that brings us to the place of obedience where God can pour out His Spirit, that is something that Satan terribly fears. He fears. He's the author of fear. What is it, friends, that can bring God's people to perfection? What great teaching do we have that is designed to bring about our purification and sanctification? Well, in the book Great Controversy on page 488, the subject of the sanctuary Amen. And the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. Friends, this means more than just a textbook knowledge. For without it, we will lose our souls. Continuing, she says, all need a knowledge for themselves of the position and work of their great high priest. Otherwise, it will be impossible for them to exercise the faith which is essential at this time, or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. So is this small stuff? This is big stuff, isn't it? It's important. It's vital. Now, why is it that in the spirit of prophecy, we find this stated so emphatically? What is there about the sanctuary that is so fundamental about our message and our mission? Why is there such a silence upon this subject so often? But when we do hear noise, it's more like static, and it comes as an attack against the sanctuary as opposed to something that profits it. Why is there such a ho-hum attitude then about the sanctuary among Seventh-day Adventists, if this is indeed such a vital topic for our spiritual health? And it's a vital topic for every church member. This has been present truth, friends, since 1844. I'd like to say I think it's a fairly simplistic answer. Satan does not want the justifying and the sanctifying truths that provide forgiveness and overcoming power, which are embodied in the sanctuary truth. He doesn't want those to come to light to you as a believer. Continuing in Great Controversy, Satan invents unnumbered schemes to occupy our minds that they may not dwell upon the very work with which we ought to be best acquainted. Notice this next sentence carefully. The arch deceiver hates the great truths that bring to view an atoning sacrifice and an all-powerful mediator. He knows that with him everything depends on his diverting minds from Jesus and His truth. Beloved, we are sanctified through truth. The Word of God is powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. John 17:17, Hebrews 4:12. We need the Word of God. We need the truth. Because that's what will sanctify us, and nothing else will. The fables of men won't do it. There are two aspects that are mentioned here. She mentions an atoning sacrifice and an all-powerful mediator.
Amen.
If we think about these things in their very fundamental components, she's talking about justification and sanctification. She's talking about the ability of Christ to forgive us our sins. But more than that, to empower us so that we don't have to keep living in sin. About a year and a half ago, I lost my dog Annie. I'm not sure what happened to her, but most likely the coyotes found her one time at a very bad place for her. But Annie was a good dog, and Annie could do a lot of things, but one thing Annie couldn't do, she couldn't fly. But now the eagle can fly. And maybe the eagle came down and talked to Annie one day and said, you know, if you could just fly like me, here, it's easy, you can do this, watch, it's very easy. And I suppose Annie said, well, yeah, it's easy for you, you got wings. You've been made to fly. And so why did I tell you that little story? Because that's the way a lot of people think that Jesus is compared to us. Yes, he lived a different kind of life than we live. He lived a perfect life. He never sinned. But he was like an eagle. He had wings. He could fly. Lord, I don't have any wings. And so we need to understand, friends, that we who are human and he who is divine are not, though, in the same category as the dog and the eagle. He is offered to let us partake of the divine nature because he partook of our human nature. And this concept of having an all-atoning sacrifice and a powerful mediator, they are inseparably linked together. Because one tells us what Jesus has done for us, and the other tells us what Jesus is doing in us. And if Satan can cause confusion on these two central truths in the plan of salvation, he really doesn't care how much else we know. In the Review on Hell of June 4, 1895, we read these statements. He who is being sanctified by the truth will be self-controlled and will follow in the footsteps of Christ until grace is lost in glory. The righteousness by which we are justified is imputed. The righteousness by which we are sanctified is imparted. The first is our title to heaven. The second is our fitness for heaven. We mentioned those terms, I think, maybe this morning. Imparted, imputed, a title, a fitness. In other words, I can come to Jesus just as I am tonight. And he gives me a title to heaven. And he has a right to do that. But the fact is, friends, I'm not fit to live in heaven yet. I'm not fit to live in heaven yet. But he wants to give me a fitness also. And he will, if I will surrender my life to him. You see, there's many things that we do that are good, that aren't wrong of themselves. But if we limit ourselves to a certain way of living or a certain box. I mean, for example, Satan doesn't care if we want to pay tithe. He doesn't care so much if we keep the Sabbath. He doesn't even really care if we believe in a monotheistic religion. Because, friends, there was people who paid tithe and kept the Sabbath and had a monotheistic religion who crucified Jesus Christ. It's not enough of itself. Satan, I believe with all my heart, fears that there will be a generation that will take God at his word and cooperate with him in the eradication of sinful habits. As Nahum 1:9 says, affliction will not rise a second time. God's going to see fit. You know, those people that Linford was talking to, these druggers and whatnot, and they said, well, you know, if God's all powerful, why didn't he stop this wickedness? Well, I'm going to tell you what, if you'd went in right then and physically tried to take all their drugs and paraphernalia from them, see how they would have liked it. Yeah. See? God knows that he can't force his love upon people. But Satan fears, Revelation chapter 12, verse 14, that there will be a people who will keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. He fears that those who sincerely desire the faith of Jesus will also develop the character of Jesus through faith in God's abiding power, and they will then prove all the charges of Satan false forever. We've been told in the book, The Desire of Ages, in the opening of the great controversy, Satan had declared that the law of God could not be obeyed, that justice was inconsistent with mercy, and that should the law be broken, it would be impossible for the sinner to be pardoned. Satan fears, friends, that men who have been once chained, women who have been once chained to selfishness and to spiritual failures, are going to demonstrate that indeed they have found in Jesus the answer. They have found the key to unlock those shackles. And they will demonstrate that God's way of life is the best, and it's also the happiest way of life. In fact, in the book Christ Object Lessons, we've read this at least once, Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. And I believe that, friends. I believe it with all my heart. And that's what he wants to do, and it's what he's going to do if you'll let him. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about systematic theology. Systematic theology is basically defined as a discipline of Christian theology that formulates an orderly, rational, and coherent account of the Christian faith and beliefs. It takes all the various concepts of belief and truth and puts them together in a coherent way. For instance, if I have a set of gears, maybe those gears represent different truths. But you know, no gear stands out by itself, does it? All of them interlock in some way with another gear. So that if you have a truth, a basic fundamental truth, like maybe the drive gear, as it turns all the other gears in the proper direction. Brother Don knows this from transmission work. But friends, if you have the wrong gear in there, it's going to turn things wrong. Or if it's turning the wrong way. And what that first fundamental gear does affects everything else. As a very simple example, if we talk about the state of people when they die, the state of the dead. If we believe that when they die, that they continue to live forever, somehow that we have an immortal, undying soul, then what is the only conclusion that we can logically and honestly come to about the length of hell? Unless you want to create a limbo or purgatory or some other place. You see how one truth affects the other. Now I'm going to read another statement, and this is a statement from a book on systematic theology by Hodges. It says, in every science, there are two factors, facts and ideas, or facts and the mind. Science is more than knowledge. Knowledge is a persuasion of what is true on adequate evidence. But the facts of astronomy, chemistry, or history do not constitute the science of those departments of knowledge, nor does the mere orderly arrangement of facts amount to science. Historical facts arranged in chronological order are mere annals. The philosophy of history supposes that those facts to be understood in their casual relations. In every department, the man of science is assumed to understand the laws by which the facts of experience are determined, so that he not only knows the past, but can predict the future. Let me just pause there. Now, he's not talking about prophetic future, but he's talking about once you have certain facts lined up. For instance, if I was to come in here and paint the floor red, just some red paint, and if I understand the principles of painting, Mac, and maybe this is an oil-based paint, am I going to come back and walk on top of that floor 15 minutes later? No, because I can predict the future of what's going to happen if I do it, because I understand how the gears all line up. I understand the chain of events. The astronomer can foretell the relative position of the heavenly bodies for centuries to come. The chemist can tell with certainty what will be the effect of certain chemical combinations. If therefore theology be a science, it must include something more than a mere knowledge of facts. It must embrace an exhibition of the eternal relation of those facts, one to another, and each to all. It must be able to show that if one be admitted, others cannot be denied. Now, I don't know if that makes sense to you, but it does to me. And it's simply saying us this, that once we start to understand all the different gears of theology, we're going to understand how they interrelate to each other, and we're going to see that one is essential to the other. And we may think of our teachings as being isolated set of beliefs. I believe this, this, and this. But what we're not maybe seeing is that all these things connect together. And so when we begin to change very fundamental points of our belief, everything else has to change somewhere down the line. It will. No matter what you think, it's going to happen. I assure you, it will happen. And I have seen in my history, and maybe you have in yours too, that when someone takes a new paradigm of thought for basic fundamental teachings, it may not come out today, it may not come out tomorrow, but somewhere down the line, if that person is logical, if that person follows from cause to effect, they're going to have different teachings and different doctrines on many things than they used to have. Because when you start with fundamental points and change those, you change the playing field for everything that comes after it. Now, within systematic theology, there's three branches I'd like to talk about for just a few minutes tonight, and the first is soteriology. This is from the Greek word soteria, which is the word we translate salvation. It's simply the science of salvation. Another field is called Christology, the study and nature of Christ and how it relates to what we call the Godhead. And then there's a third thing that Adventists are very particular about, and that's called eschatology. That's from the Greek word eschatos, which means last or last things. It's the study of last day events. And I'd like to propose to you that all of these three are inseparably linked together, and systematic theology proves it. That the basic fundamental points we believe about salvation will affect what we believe about Jesus Christ. And all of that is going to also affect us as Seventh-day Adventists and what we believe the last day events, the end time scenario, is going to be like. Now, most systematic theologians, if you study almost any of the books, and I don't care if it is a Presbyterian, a Baptist, a Methodist, or a Seventh-day Adventist, you study the systematic theology books, or you take a course in systematic theology, the most fundamental point that they're going to start discussing on soteriology is sin. You say, well, I want to be saved from sin. Why am I going to talk about sin? Well, they're going to talk about sin because it's so foundational, because so much else builds upon it. Now, we need to understand how to define things, and we need to understand that there's a difference between a definition and an illustration, or a definition and an example. For instance, if I told you that a Mustang is a car, does that define what a car is? It gives an illustration. It gives an example of what a car is. But an automobile is actually a road vehicle, typically with four wheels, powered by an internal combustion, or today electrical engine, and able to carry a small number of people. That's a basic fundamental definition of an automobile. If I say I have a Mustang, or if I have a Camaro, or a Camry, or an F-150, those are examples or illustrations of an automobile, but they're not definitions of an automobile, okay? In 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4, the Bible says, "Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law." The New King James says, "Whosoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness." The Greek word lawlessness, or the Greek word that's translated lawlessness here, is anomia. It's from the Greek word nomos, which is the word for law. And in Greek, you put the little a or the alpha in front of it, and makes it a negative. And so it means that which is against the law, or lawlessness. And this is what the Bible says that sin is. Now, we have a very good God who understands that sometimes we don't always see everything so quickly and clearly. And there's a text in Romans chapter 4 I'd like to turn to now. Romans chapter 4 and verse 15. It says, "Because the law worketh wrath, for where there is no law, there is no what? Transgression. In other words, if we do not understand a point of God's law, does he impute sin to us? No, he doesn't. If there's no law, there's no way to impute sin to us. In Leviticus chapter 5 and verse 3, it says, if he touches human uncleanness, whatever sort of uncleanness it is with which the man may be defiled, it is hidden from him. When he realizes it, he shall be guilty. So when it comes to our light, we are guilty. But if there's no law, there's no sin, or if we don't understand it yet, God doesn't impute it against us. But the fact is, friends, that if there's anybody who should understand the Ten Commandments, and that's what John's talking about in 1 John 3:4, is the Ten Commandments, it's very clear. If there's anyone who understands that, it should be Seventh-day Adventist people. Would you agree with that?
Amen.
I would. And in a heavenly vision, Ellen White was told by an angel, and that's why I have it in quote marks here, it is the essence of sin to allow ourselves to become a contradiction of God's will. And how is God's will expressed? It's expressed in his law, friends. It's expressed in his law. And Ellen G. White frequently emphasizes the message of 1 John 3:4 as the only definition of sin. And we can believe it or we don't have to. Let me just read you a couple. What is sin? The only definition that is given to you in the Word of God is sin is the transgression of the law. I would say to you that every other place that you read about something about sin that seems to define sin is simply a clarification of this basic fundamental definition in 1 John 3:4. Now, we don't have to believe this statement. We can take this statement and we can say, you know what? This statement's not as smart as I am. Well, let me ask you a question. If I was to tell you tonight, well, yes, I believe in Ellen White, but I don't agree with this because my understanding of the Bible is different. I might not be openly saying, but really, friends, I think I'm smarter than what she has for inspiration. Amen. Isn't that right?
Amen.
I mean, am I being honest?
Yes.
She also says in Signs of the Times, March 3, 1890, in order to let Jesus into our hearts, we must stop sinning. The only definition for sin that we have in the Bible is that it is the transgression of the law. The law is far-reaching in its claims, and we must bring our hearts into harmony with it. And of course, we understand, friends, that the law is more than simply our actions. It's all the things that we think. It's the intents of our hearts. It goes extremely deep. Now, maybe you've heard of a couple terms here we put on the board, Calvinism and Arminianism. Have you ever heard of these terms before? Because these are very different systems of theology.
Yes.
Calvinism and Arminianism. And we can look at a lot of differences about those different systems of theology. But they're based upon, actually when you look at them, you see all these differences. But when you come down to the bottom line, they tend to have only one or two basic fundamental differences in the beginning. But those basic fundamental differences then start to branch out and turn other gears up the way and make a lot of changes. Well, Calvinism, of course, goes back to John Calvin, and Arminianism to Jacob Arminia. But they had some very different thoughts on the issues of predestination, free will, but they also had some very different ideas about what sin is. And in Calvinism, sin is more like a disease. Sin is your very nature. And you are born a sinner. Now, you might not think that you believe in Calvinism, but if you believe that human beings are born sinners, then that is Calvinism. That's part of the Calvinistic theology. Now, Adventism, in prior history at least, has never believed in Calvinism. We have been solid Arminians.
Amen.
In our theology, in that we believe that God gives us free will. We are not predestined to be either saved or to be lost. I remember I was talking to the man who was running a MRI machine one day, and we somehow got to discussing this. He was a very, very confirmed Calvinist, and he didn't spare any language to let me know in a kind way. He said, look here, he said, how can you explain it? He said, I was a sinner. He said, I was drinking. I was doing all kinds of carousing. I was mean. I was rude. He said, one morning I woke up and I said, God's got me, and that's it. And I changed. He says, because God decided to save me at that very moment. I didn't have anything to do with it whatsoever. That's what he said. Well, I'll let him discuss that with God. But I believe that God has given to every one of us free will. And when we choose to do right or we choose to do wrong, then we are putting ourselves either in the Lord's camp or we're putting ourselves in Satan's camp. Now, in Isaiah chapter 59, I want you to notice this text because this text is pivotal. Isaiah chapter 59 and verse 2. And I'm going to read this text as John Calvin would probably like to read the text first. But Adam's sin has separated between you and your God, and Adam's sin has hid his face from you that he will not hear. Now, is that what the text says?
No.
No, but that's basically, fundamentally, the way a Calvinist understands this text. There's this concept of covenant theology, or sometimes called federal theology, that we belong to a corpus of humanity and we were all in Adam, and so in Adam all men sin. And when Adam sinned, we all became sinners in him. But in Christ, well, we're supposed to all be made alive if the text is parallel, but of course the Calvinist says, no, there's some people who are going to be lost. But the text actually says that your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. It doesn't say that Adam sinned, does this, friends? So how do we really understand this? Well, I'd like to propose as Herbert Douglas said, any argument that puts sin first above human accountability is an argument for original sin, whatever one may call it. In other words, whenever we take human accountability and we put it below, then this is just another way of arguing the doctrine of original sin. This was the theology of Augustine. Let me go on. But by sin, this is Desire of Ages, page 23. By sin, we have been severed from the life of God. Our souls are palsied. She says in Review and Herald of July 12, 1887, just as soon as we separate ourselves from God by sin, which is the transgression of the law, Satan takes control of our minds. We want to seek earnestly to draw near to God. Now she's talking about us being separated from God. Is it something that we were born as that separates us from God, or is it our sin that separates us from God? Does this make sense? Are you following the pathway that I'm proposing here? And slide number 30, I believe it is. We are not to regard God as waiting to punish the sinner for his sin. The sinner brings the punishment upon himself. His own actions start a train of circumstances that bring the sure result. Every act of transgression reacts upon the sinner, works in him a change of character, and makes it more easy for him to transgress again. By choosing to sin, men separate themselves from God, cut themselves off from the channel of blessing, and the sure result is ruin and death. It says here that by our own actions, we start or begin a train of circumstances that brings a result, and it's a sure result. It's not Adam's. It's not someone else's. In the 1888 materials, in a letter she was writing to Uriah Smith, she says, God does not separate from his people, but his people separate themselves from God by their own course of action. In other words, we are not separated from God by being born, but by a conscious choice. At the same time, we must always remember the uneven playing field that every person lives on. In the book Ministry of Healing, on page 168, she says, consider the power of heredity, the influence of evil associations and surroundings, the power of wrong habits. Can we wonder that under such influences many become degraded? Can we wonder that they should be slow to respond to efforts for their uplifting? Often, when won to the gospel, those who appeared coarse and unpromising will be among its most loyal adherents and advocates. They are not altogether corrupt. That's an interesting statement. And so, like Brother Linford, when you're talking to these young people, you know, Some of those young people may be the best Christians, the hardest, most zealous workers someday for the Lord because of your witnessing to them. Because there's something still in them that's responding, that can respond to the gospel, that can say, you know, maybe I need to look at this again. Because, friends, sin is a voluntary choice on our part. In Ezekiel chapter 18, Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 20. You know this verse. Ezekiel 18, verse 20. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. This really is a very difficult text for federalists to deal with. And we could look at other texts. Let's turn to John chapter 9. And verse 41. John chapter 9 and verse 41. Jesus has been speaking to the Pharisees, and they say, are we blind also? And Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you should have no sin. But now you say we see, therefore your sin remaineth. Your sin, not someone else's sin. John chapter 15, verse 22. John 15, verse 22. Jesus says, if I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin, but now they have no cloak for their sin. Not someone else's sin, their sin. Because of their response to truth, or their non-response to truth. That's what will determine, friends, whether we're living righteously or we're living sinfully. In James chapter 4, verse 17, therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is what?
Sin.
It is. That's right. Now, I think Brother Carter was clarifying a point last night, that temptation is not a sin. Is it a sin to be tempted?
No.
I'm glad that you could answer that quickly without thinking too much. If sin was a temptation, then what about Jesus in the wilderness of temptation? It'd be pretty hard, wouldn't it, Dan? It's not a sin to be tempted. In fact, while we're in James, let's go to James chapter 1. Verses 14 and 15. He says, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin when it is finished, bringeth forth death. In March 27 of 1888 in the Review and Herald, we are told, there are thoughts and feelings suggested and aroused by Satan that annoy even the best of men. But if they are not cherished, if they are repulsed as hateful, the soul is not contaminated with guilt and no other is defiled by their influence.
Amen.
That's right. In Desire of Ages, page 512, Ellen White speaks here, and she quotes from the 91st Psalm. She says, even the babe in its mother's arms may dwell as under the shadow of the Almighty through the faith of the praying mother. What an encouragement for mothers with young children. John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit from his birth. If we will live in communion with God, we too may expect the divine spirit to mold our little ones even from their what?
Earliest
moments. And God's able to do that. And I'm just so glad for the text we mentioned the other night in Acts chapter 10, verse 34, where Peter said that God is no respecter of persons. And it's what he did for Elizabeth. He'll do for mothers today, too. That's right. Now, I'm just going to propose to you a challenge. But I believe that if you will take the comprehensive writings of Ellen G. White that have been published that we have, and they're on computer now. They're on the internet. If you don't have the disk, you can search them. And we have these abilities to use an electronic concordance. So we can find every single time she ever used a particular word. We can find every single time there's ever a particular phrase used in her writings. Okay? And I would like to challenge that you will never ever find that she says that we are born sinners, or born transgressors, or any combination of any phrase that suggests that we were born as involuntary sinners. Amen. I challenge you to find me a statement in the Spirit of Prophecy that says that. You won't. It's not there. In the Ministry of Healing, also on page 175. Those who put their trust in Christ are not to be enslaved by any hereditary or cultivated habit or tendency. Instead of being held in bondage to the lower nature, they are to rule every appetite and passion. God has not left us to battle with evil in our own finite strength. Whatever may be our inherited or cultivated tendencies to wrong, we may overcome through the power that He is ready to impart.
Amen.
That's right. We should say amen to that. We do realize, beloved, that we inherit tendencies to do wrong. We inherit the tendency to have a temper or to be intemperate or to be alcoholic even. But we have power provided, friends, for everything that we've inherited as well as everything that we have cultivated on our own. And I tell you, when I was young, I did a lot of farming. I cultivated a lot. And I'm still dealing with some of that today. Now, what are some of the implications of this, and why really does it matter? That's what we need to know. If sin, please take this carefully, if sin is a disease, if sin is our nature, then I ask you a very simple question. Could Jesus come and truly take our nature and be pure, holy, and undefiled? In Hebrews chapter 7, we're close to Hebrews, we've been in James. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26, he says, "For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens." 7:26, I'm sorry. Hebrews 7:26. In other words, friends, did Jesus come as an eagle wearing a dog suit? Do you get it? Did he come as an eagle wearing a dog suit? So it looked like he's like us, but really he can fly. He can do things that we can't do. Because if being born as I am, if that's what makes me a sinner, friends, then Jesus had no part with me. And he had no part with you. Now I'll ask a question. This one is a little harder. Did Jesus have a sinful nature?
Yes.
Did Jesus have
a sinful nature?
He had an inherited nature.
Well, I would like to use the language of inspiration because I think it's more accurate and more careful. He took upon his sinless nature, our sinful nature, that he might know how to succor those that are tempted. I'm a little cautious to say Jesus had a sinful nature, but he took upon his sinless nature, our sinful nature. And he knew all that it meant and all that it was in every detail. Hebrews chapter 2, if we could look there. Hebrews chapter 2. And verse 14, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same." Well, did he or didn't he? "That through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil." Verse 16, Hebrews 2:16. "For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore, in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people." I believe that Romans chapter 8, verses 3 and 4 was read last night also. Maybe another time as well. You want to read it again? Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verses 3 and 4. "For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh." Now I'll ask you a question. Is the law weak of itself? No, the law is not weak at all. But through the flesh becomes weak because it can't keep the law of itself. It says, "For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh." Why? Verse 4. "That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." How could these texts be true? How could John 3:14 be true if Calvinism is correct? And here we see that our view of soteriology, our understanding of sin, affects our Christology. It affects the way that we view Jesus Christ. Now let's take this to the next step. Let's go to John 16:33. John 16, verse 33. I think Brother Fred made reference to this text earlier. Jesus says, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." Did he really overcome the world?
Yes.
And does he make it available for us to overcome the world? In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15. I'm at Hebrews 4:15. He says, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." Now, the beginning of this verse is a little difficult because there's two negatives in it. And we could really restate it in a positive way, saying that we do have a high priest who is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. And the reason for that is because he was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. But if he doesn't really know my struggles because he had some advantage over me, born in a different way or born with something that I can't have access to, then how could he truly understand my struggles, friends? How could he truly come down to my level? But you see, if you follow Calvinism out to its logical conclusions, and I tell you, a lot of theologians have, that's not a problem because they don't expect you to be able to keep God's law. You're not expected to perfect your character. It's not expected in Calvinism, friends. It's not part of the theology. And I'm going to tell you that when you accept the basic fundamental points of Calvinism, if you are logical and if you are honest, if you follow them out, this is where they eventually lead. Whether you see it tonight or not, I'm telling you the truth, it's where they will lead you. If our view of sin is distorted, which distorts our view of Jesus, and he did not take our nature, then how can we become overcomers as he overcame? Revelation chapter 3 and verse 21. Jesus says, "To him that overcometh, well, I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and sit down with my Father in his throne." Right? So did Jesus really overcome as we have to overcome?
Amen.
On a similar playing field, a level playing field.
Amen.
In God's Amazing Grace, page 111, we are told, "Christ has made it possible for every member of the human family to resist temptation. All who would live godly lives may overcome as Christ overcame." In other words, the formula that Jesus used, and I think Brother DeMario was talking about that some last night, this way that Jesus overcame is the same way that I have to overcome. And we can do that because we're playing on the same field. In Selected Messages, book 1, page 409, "Christ, by his own example, made it evident that man may stand in integrity. Man may have a power to resist evil, a power that neither earth nor death nor hell can master, a power that will place them where they may overcome as Christ overcame. Divinity and humanity may be combined in them." And I think we had a reference also in one of our other meetings to 1 Peter 1:4. That by these great and precious promises, friends, we can become a partaker of the divine nature and escape the lust of this world, the corruption of the lust of this world. And it's the only way we can do it because of our own humanity. By itself, with nothing else, unaided, friends, we can do nothing. Jesus said, "Without me, you can do nothing." And do you think he really meant? I think he meant every syllable of it. Absolutely. We have to be dependent totally upon divine power. And this is the secret of success, is having divinity and humanity combined. In Testimonies, volume 4, on page 36, "If we poor mortals reach heaven, we must overcome as Christ overcame. We must be assimilated to his image. Our characters must be spotless." Now, I highlighted one of those musts, but if you see the way I have the sentence lined up here, there's three musts in there. And in English, we would say that becomes something that's emphatic. It must. It's not optional. It has to be. in our experience. Three things here. We must be assimilated in His image. Our characters must be spotless, and we must overcome as Christ overcame. Again, if sin is a disease or our nature, then Jesus could not have come as we are and could not have overcome as we overcome. And friends, that kind of theology that says sin is disease never existed in Adventism until 1957.
Amen.
And you know what happened in 1957? A book called Questions on Doctrine was published. And that volume became the primer for every minister who went to seminary thereafter. And it is still the primer for our ministers today. In 2007, 50 years after the book was originally published, there was a conference held at Andrews University, the 50th anniversary of the publishing Questions on Doctrine. I attended that, and some of the other folks are here tonight did. And the dean of the seminary, the then dean of the seminary, Dennis Fort, and he's not the dean now, but he was the dean at that time, he stood up and he very publicly, very plainly, without any apologies, he said, "We stand behind the theology of Questions on Doctrine, and this is what our seminary teaches, this is what we support, and this is what our ministers go out to teach." And he wasn't just talking about the little sections that we all might agree upon, the sections about Michael or eternal hell or something like that. He was talking about the issues of Christology and soteriology. And this is what's happened, friends. We have a new mindset that has come into Adventism in the last 50 plus years because of this theology. And may I also say, though, in going back just a step further, the conferences that resulted in the book Questions on Doctrine, the conferences that happened in 1955 and 1956 between certain leading Adventist ministers, specifically Roy Allen Anderson, Reed and Froom, and also Theodore Undrew, those meetings with Walter Martin and Donald Barnhouse, George Cannon, would have never happened if we had stayed non-Trinitarian. Because Walter Martin came to Roy Allen Anderson's office. He was the ministerial director at that time of the church. Came to his office in Washington, D.C. at the time, and he said to him, he says, "Now, you are Trinitarian, aren't you? Because if you're not, everything stops right now, and we don't have anything happening." And Anderson said, "Well, of course, I could show him from the 1941 or 31 Statement of Belief that we were Trinitarian." And he says, "Good enough for me. Let's go forward now." But you see how one thing can affect another and start bringing out problems? That's right. If Jesus had some kind of advantage over us that we do not have access to, then this results in Satan being able to say that God has not played fair. We're told that if Christ had a special power, which it is not the privilege of man to have, Satan would have made capital of this matter. The work of Christ was to take from the claims of Satan his control of man, and he could do this only in the way he came, a man, tempted as a man, rendering the obedience of a man. She continues, this is in Selected Messages, Book 3. "Bear in mind that Christ's overcoming and obedience is that of a true human being. In our conclusions, we make many mistakes because of our erroneous views of the human nature of our Lord. When we give to His human nature a power that it is not possible for man to have in his conflicts with Satan, we destroy the completeness of His humanity. His imputed grace and power He gives to all who receive Him by faith. The obedience of Christ to His Father was the same obedience that is required of man."
Amen.
And that's not Calvinism.
Amen.
That's good Arminianism. So, did Jesus then have an advantage that we may not have? Well, in Desire of Ages on page 644, we are told that Jesus revealed no qualities and exercised no powers that men may not have through faith in Him. Now, I know that there's different views on exactly in what way Jesus was divine when He came to this earth. But the fact is, she says here, and perhaps at least in this aspect, irrespective of how we see the other point, that there's nothing that Jesus had that we don't have accessibility to. Whatever He had, or didn't have, or whatever He had accessibility to, we have too.
Amen.
His perfect humanity is that which all His followers may possess if they will be in subjection to God as He was.
Amen.
And so, friends, tonight God isn't necessarily looking for perfect knowledge. He's looking for a perfect heart. He's looking for a heart that will love righteousness and hate iniquity. He's looking for a heart that's willing to be changed. Because, friends, if I don't have the right knowledge, or if I make a mistake today and I just don't see what I'm doing, the Lord can correct me. He can show me a better way. And if I have the heart that loves righteousness, I'll want to do it. And I'll see my error and I will repent in sackcloth and ashes. Now, in these two fields of theology, in Calvinism and Arminianism, there are two different thoughts about how Jesus was to live. One says that Jesus was our substitute, and he was our substitute all the way through. He lived vicariously for us. He died vicariously for us. He obeyed vicariously for us. You interestingly take out the Adventist Words of the Pioneer CD and look up the word vicarious and see how much it was used by our pioneers. This word was almost nil in existence in Adventism prior to questions on doctrine. But after questions on doctrine, we see this kind of idea that everything that Jesus does is vicarious. In other words, friends, salvation is by substitution and only by substitution. Now, we agree and we understand that Jesus had to die for me. There's no question about that. He had to accept my sin and he had to die for me. He is my substitute. But friends, he's more. And this is where Arminianism must break with Calvinism. Because the Arminian concept says that he, yes, he's a substitute for me as a Savior. He died for my sins. But he set me an example of how I might live as he lived. So salvation isn't simply just substitution. Salvation is substitution and example. It's substitution and even imitation. Ellen White, I don't have them tonight, but Ellen White over and over says that we are to imitate Christ. We are to imitate Christ. And I'm going to tell you this, and you may or may not believe me, but you follow it. You just follow it out. The people who teach you that salvation is all substitution, they will come down to the place that they'll say, no, that there's nothing about example here. There's nothing about that we are to imitate. Salvation has nothing to do with imitation. And it's going to eventually lead to antinomianism and to putting down of God's law. And I've seen it develop in the last decade. And if you haven't, friends, you haven't looked. Because it's become quite blatant in some places. Do you agree with me on that?
Amen.
Yes.
It has. We're told in Ministry of Healing, by the way, that's a good book. If you've never read it, you should read that book. Ministry of Healing, page 181. Christ lived a life of perfect obedience to God's law. Well, a lot of people would like for it to stop there, but it doesn't. And in this, he set an example for every human being. Now, friends, what is the purpose of having an example? To show you how to do it. There'd be no sense in Jesus leaving us an example if we weren't to follow in that example. The faith I live by. Men and women frame many excuses in their proneness to sin. Sin is represented as a necessity, an evil that cannot be overcome. But sin is not a necessity. Christ lived in this world from infancy to manhood, and during that time he met and resisted all the temptations by which man is beset. He is a perfect pattern of childhood, of youth, of manhood. And to me, friends, for those who still have young children, that should be very encouraging. I wish I had had a better grasp on this 30-some years ago when my children were younger. It would have helped me. I understood some of these principles, but I just didn't understand how clearly they could play out into our lives and be a practical use to us. Sometimes, you know, we hear this word theology, but the word theology itself is not a bad word. It simply means the study of God. Theo, theos, God in the Greek, study of God. And it's very practical if we can put it into these kind of considerations. Now, there's this 2,000-year-old controversy over the humanity of Christ. And it's not merely academic or theoretical in discussion. It involves how we're going to live. It involves the kind of lives that we are going to be producing. Getting the humanity of Jesus right has everything to do with the kind of people God's waiting to fulfill the promise of the sealing by. In Revelation chapter 7, if we could turn to Revelation chapter 7. Verse Verse 1, and after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. Verse 2, and I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and their number was, and the number were sealed were 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. And he goes on, he talks about these different tribes. And then Revelation chapter 14. In verse 4. These are they which are not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the firstfruits unto God and to the Lamb. And then he says in verse 5, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. That's a high standard, isn't it? That's a pretty high standard. God interrupts everything going on this earth to make sure that these people get sealed. Things are ready to explode and implode in this earth. And God says, not yet. But then when the time comes, he says, you can let loose the winds because my people are sealed now. But he's holding everything back now. You know, we see all these things happening. We wonder, when's they all going to explode? It's going to explode, friends, when God's people get sealed. And it's going to be soon. Understanding our Lord's purpose in the heavenly sanctuary will clarify the message and the mission of Adventist people. That we not only can have forgiveness, friends, we can not only have the ability to say, my sins are forgiven, but we can have the ability to say, I don't have to live in sin anymore. And so I'd like to propose to you that the Adventist Church was raised up to prepare honest seekers of truth to be translated and not to die. Amen. That's what Adventism is about. That preparation involves a people who will let the Holy Spirit complete God's work of changing rebellious hearts into cheerful followers of Jesus Christ. People who are so settled into the truth that nothing can move them, and they will never, ever sin again. They will never say no to God again. More personally, getting the humanity of Jesus right will add more reality to our prayers as men and women, as boys and girls, as we go through the practical struggles of living in an evil, sin-infested world. Knowing that Jesus experienced every temptation to the lower nature common to each one of us. Now there's a third part, and that's eschatology and how that fits in. And we're going to talk about it tomorrow night.